Fifth Hunnigest. The Law of Kings. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, one God. Vesemab, Weweld, Wemen Fesk Edus, Ahadu, Amlak. Part 2. On the matters which secular rulers must govern, on the acts which must be specifically allowed and prohibited, and on the rules regarding dwelling place. We have already made an index of the chapters of this part in part 1. Chapter 23, the food, clothing, dwelling place, and trades proper for Christians. With regards to food, there is no prohibition in the Christian law, with the exception of what the apostles forbade in the book of the Acts and in their canons, saying, "It is the Holy Spirit's pleasure and ours that we should not lay upon you a burden heavier than that abstinence which is absolutely necessary, namely, that you abstain from eating blood, meat from strangled animals, the sacrifice of idols, and the residue of what was eaten by animals. These things are forbidden because of the spiritual ill which is in them, since by sharing with the idolaters in the eating of what they sacrifice to their idols, a Christian becomes an associate in their cult. This leads him to the cult of idols. These things are also forbidden because of the corporal and spiritual ill in them, which disturbs the composition of the body and leads to the corruption of human nature and to the ruin of the bodily organs. These foods are not forbidden as things impure by their nature, since they come from God's creatures, and a saying is written for us in the law which runs, and God saw that all he made was very good. In the gospel also, our Lord said, all which goes into the mouth of a man cannot defile him. Chrysostom has said in regard to this that the Lord abolished with this word the greater part of the precepts of the ancient law. His statement is confirmed by what is said in the Acts of the Apostles, in the words of Luke, who said, Peter went up to the housetop at about noon to pray there. He was hungry and wanted to eat, and while they were preparing the food, he fell asleep. He saw the heavens open, and a bundle like a great linen sheet held at four corners was descending on the earth. In it were all kinds of four-footed beasts, and all things that creep on the earth, and birds of heaven. And a voice came to him, Arise, Peter, kill and eat. Far be it from me, Lord, answered Peter, for I never did eat anything impure and unclean. And again the voice called him and said, That which God has cleansed do not thou call unclean. And this word was repeated three times. The saintly teachers, Chrysostom, and other fathers understood from this that in it there are two meanings. The first is an allegoric sense, that from now on we must not consider people who do not believe so impure that the faithful must not associate with them, as was prescribed in the ancient law. The second is a literal sense, that is, we must know that all animals are pure. There is no prohibition against eating what by natural knowledge is good. Nourishment also is in all animals except eating blood, things strangled, things sacrificed to idols, and the residue of what has been eaten by animals. To us is allowed not to be forbidden anything except that which the law forbids as leading to the ruin of the soul and nature, and to the spoiling of the body. This is divided into two parts. The first is about what is suitable neither for food nor for medicine, not only among animals but also among plants. These are the animals which have poison, like rapacious animals which have nails and fangs, or animals which feed on poisons, and deadly plants which, on being eaten, spoil the intelligence and the entire body. But, notwithstanding this prohibition, when within the food of this part there is a kind which harms a healthy man but heals a sick man, the healthy one shall abstain from eating it, while the sick one is permitted to eat it as medicine. The second part deals with one who is doubtful about food and with one who scandalizes his neighbor by eating it. To these two parts the Apostle Paul refers when he says in the letters to the Romans, Strengthen the one who is weak in faith and do not be scandalized in your heart. The one who believes that everything may be eaten, let him eat everything. And the one who is weak in his willpower, let him feed on vegetables. But the one who eats everything shall not despise the other who does not eat, nor shall the latter judge him who eats, since God is in him. And it is known, and I believe, that there is nothing unclean in our Lord Jesus Christos. But if there is a man who doubts that it is unclean, it will be unclean for him only, since everything is clean, but is evil for the man who eats with doubt. If it is not good, we shall not eat meat nor drink wine, nor do anything by which our brothers may be scandalized. And the one who hesitates, if he eats, is condemned, since he has not acted with faith, and whatever does not proceed from faith is sin. And we, the community of the faithful, must bear the weakness of the waverers. And St. Paul also said in his first letter to the Corinthians, everything is allowed to me, but I must not give everyone power over me. Since food is meant for the stomach, and the stomach is meant for food. As for the eating of that which is sacrificed to the idols, we know that the idol is nothing in this world, and there is no other God but the only God. But the knowledge of these things is not in all men, and the food does not bring us closer to God. For neither will we have more if we eat, nor will we have less if we do not eat. Mind you, see now that the power you have may not cause scandal to the weak. Thus, if food scandalizes my brother, I will abstain from flesh perpetually, so that my brother may not be scandalized. I am free to do what I will, but not everything is profitable to me. I am free to do everything, but not everything is good and edifying. Eat everything which is sold in the market, and do not make inquiry about his intention, since the earth in its fullness belongs to God. If an unbeliever invites you to eat, and you accept, you may eat whatever is put before you without asking. But if he has said, this is sacrificed to the idols, you must refuse to eat, because of the word of the one who said it to you. St. Paul also said in his letter to Timothy in chapter 4, they despise and forbid foods which God has created for the profit and thankfulness of those who believe and recognize the truth. All is good that God has made, and nothing is to be rejected when it is received with thankfulness, for all is hallowed by the word of God and by prayer. The priest and the bishop shall not declare unclean any foods except those which are forbidden by the law of God. It is recommended that Christians and the clergy among them, and especially monks, not be subjected to diversity in the quality of their food, and to pleasure derived from its taste and smell, its tenderness and beauty, which lead to sin. But they shall feed themselves for the benefit of the body, that it may be sustained for the few days of its mortal life. And they shall feed themselves upon what is available to the greater number in their place and in their time. As our Lord has said, what is the use of living in comfort and of caring for the many things in this world? Indeed, what is required is little, only one thing. And his apostle followed him, saying, let us be content, since we have our food and clothing. And also our Lord has said, look to yourselves against gluttony and drunkenness. He called blessed those who hunger and thirst for holiness, and made their remuneration the kingdom of heaven. As for clothing, the canons deal with every detail concerning it. The canons forbid fine clothes, adorned and embroidered with colors, and order that for the service of the sanctuary, white clothes are to be worn. Women shall not wear the clothes of men, and men in their turn shall not wear those of women. Men shall not put on rings, nor shall women wear clothes embroidered with gold, which makes them proud. Monks shall wear rough clothes of wool, or something similar. Regarding laymen, the canons have not specified the rules governing the clothes permitted to them. Everyone shall dress and adorn himself as he wishes, according to the fashion of the time, as will the dependents of the magistrates. Priests shall not wear the clothes of soldiers, the clothes of carpenters, or the clothes of scholars. From all these, the disciples of Christ shall abstain. They must guard themselves against having those clothes, since the Lord has taught his disciples not to have many clothes, and praised John the Baptist because he did not dress in soft clothes. The admirable prophets, The saintly apostles and the wise who, like John the Baptist, did not use fine clothes deserve the same praise. John Chrysostom has said, "The faithful must be recognized by their meals, by their adornment, by their talk, their behavior, and similar things, since our law has delivered us and estranged us from all this." And the wise Saint Basil has said, "We must arrange our clothes to cover our nakedness, must have what is sufficient for our need, and must protect ourselves from cold and heat, and observe the rule of the hermits." And the observance of this rule helps to distinguish us from laymen, since laymen dress in what is available for the greater number of them, but the dress of monks must be rough clothes of wool. As for the dwelling place, it must be according to this law, which is for those who are perfect, who reject transitory things and look for durable things, as it is good that their food and their clothing be according to that which is established for them, that is, only enough to keep all afflictions. So also is the precept regarding dwellings, that is, it must be big enough to shelter those who dwell in it and to accommodate the food necessary for them. Our Lord Jesus Christus has said that we must live according to the example of his deeds when he became man, and taught that we must walk in perfection according to his words and his deed. He said to us that he had no dwelling, no place to lay down his head, and his apostles who followed him praised those who dwelt in the rocks and caverns, and said that the world was unworthy to contain them. The saints and the wise men considered themselves as travelers and pilgrims in this world. In fact, such is our life in this world, and Chrysostom has said in his admonition that regarding the dwelling of the guests and pilgrims, it is known that they request, and it is provided to them according to their need at that moment. Now, one who considers the last divine and heavenly dwelling searches for it, and thinks in his mind that he will not remain in this earthly dwelling but for a brief time, why should he tire himself enlarging and making this earthly dwelling strong? And why should he complain for what he will leave, though it is fine? As for trades, all are permitted except those of worldly works, which are against the will of the law, such as sorcery, witchcraft, the making of idols, or their ornaments, the invoking of demons, sorcerers, and dancers, and the amusing and rhythmic noise made by feet keeping time. Thus has said Abulides, Saint Hippolytus, in the 11th canon, "And every silversmith shall abstain from making idols, neither shall he be an artisan of statues, nor a painter, nor shall he engage in any other handicraft. And if someone, after baptism, is found doing work which is not allowed to Christian people, he shall be put apart until he repents." The canons written to the Christians from the precepts of Paul have said, "Whosoever makes idols and plays musical instruments, dancers, those who desire to please others, and people like this shall be set apart. Otherwise, they shall be driven away by excommunication. And it is known that the things mentioned, which are forbidden, are certainly not necessary for men. It is better that the people who do these things be absent than that men be ruined." The trades suitable for Christians in corporal life are divided into two parts. The first is what is necessary to sustain the body, such as sowing, reaping to gather food, fishing, weaving, sewing clothes, building, making instruments for dwelling, and preparing medicine in order to obtain health and to drive out sickness. The second part deals with those trades which are necessary to execute those enumerated above, such as the trades of carpentry or carpenters, smiths, scribes, millers, bakers, dyers of clothes, teachers, and merchants, since commerce is obviously necessary to bring into a country things found in another. Sailors and shipbuilders are meant for commerce, and it is good that one learn from all these trades only what is required to supply the necessary needs. Do not turn your whole attention to seeds and to multiplying fruit plants and flowers, neither to the weaving of colored clothes, nor to the multiplying of the weave, nor to the construction and adornment of the house, nor to making it large and high. The explanation of the wise Chrysostom dealt with these things when he commented on the Gospel according to Matthew. Chapter 24, Betrothal, Dowry, Marriage, and what follows them. This chapter is divided into six sections. Section 1. Before dealing with marriage, we must recall What are its primary purposes? For the primary purposes of marriage are two. The first is the procreation of offspring, in order to preserve the lineage. It is demonstrated by the word of God, who said to the first progenitors, increase and multiply. This cannot take place except through carnal union. The second purpose, since concupiscence is rooted in animal nature, is satisfaction of the desire for carnal union, wherefrom come offspring. And this responds to two necessities of life. First, the satisfaction of concupiscence by carnal union for procreation. Second, the cooperation which takes place between the married couple to alleviate the burdens of this life. This is demonstrated by the word of the Highest, who said in regard to Adam, it is not well that Adam shall be alone. Let us make for him a companion who may help him. The primary end of marriage is to procreate, to remove concupiscence, to bestow mutual help, and to be united. Marriage, as with early man, and in accordance with the primary law mentioned before, means that man must take a woman in marriage. Marriage also concerns the latter law, promulgated in the fulfillment of this world, and it is divided into three parts. First part. Since the fire of concupiscence causes many people to fall into transgression of the law, marriage similar to that of Adam is thus, it is good that man take a wife. This is manifested by the statement of Paul, who said in his first letter to the Corinthians, I say this to those who have no woman, and to the widows, it is good for them if they remain as I am, but if they cannot be contained, let them marry, since to marry is better than to burn by concupiscence. Paul also shows this when he says in the first letter to Timothy, on the wandering widows, I would that the young women among them be married, bear children, and have their households to manage, so that the enemy may not find the occasion for derision. Second part, it is good for the one who can overcome concupiscence by the goodness of his temper, by his good habit, or by the good example which he follows to abstain from marriage. And the saying of the Apostle Paul, in the first letter to the Corinthians, shows this. As for the question on which you have written to me, it is a good thing for man not to approach women, but for avoiding fornication, let every man live with his own wife, and every woman live with her own husband. I say this according to that which is possible for the weak, not by an absolute imposition. But I wish that everyone should be in the same state as myself in purity. Also, since God has bestowed his grace upon everyone, there is one whose grace is in living in marriage, and another whose endowment is in living in virginity. Concerning virginity, I have no commandment from the Lord, but advise you regarding it as a man to whom God has given the grace to be faithful. I believe that virginity is good, for this is an age of wickedness, and in such an age it is better for man to remain thus. If thou, O man, art tied to thy wife, seek not to be separated from her. And if thou art one who does not desire a woman, do not seek her, since affliction and distress of the body shall befall those who are in this condition. But I spare you, and I say to you, O brethren, since the day is near, and therefore I would have you remain free from affliction. For he who is unmarried is concerned with the Lord's claims, that is, how he is to please God. But he who is married is concerned with the world's claim, that is, how he is to please his wife. This is divided into two parts, since between the one who is married and the one who is a virgin, there is a well-known difference. A woman who does not belong to a man is concerned with things which bring her near to God, so that she may be pure in her body and soul. But the woman who is married is concerned with the world's claim, that is, how she is to please her husband. And I said this for your own profit, not to entrap you, but for the purpose that you may always have the care of drawing near to God, according to the good example, having no care of the things of this world. And if anyone thinks that he will be derided and is ashamed because of his virginity, since the time of marriage is past, it is suitable for him to marry. Let him do so, and he is not a sinner. But if he has made up his mind to preserve his virginity, none shall press him to transgress, since he has done the best deed. And everyone who gives up his virginity for marriage has done well. But the one who does not give up his virginity for marriage has done better. And the apostle said, This in conformity with the words of our Lord, who said in the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. At the end of the chapter, there are eunuchs who have made themselves eunuchs of their own will for the kingdom of heaven, and who may bear, let them bear. And he said this in reply to the words of the disciples when they said to him, If the law of the man with his wife is so, it is not right to marry. With this word our Lord did not say to cut off the organ of procreation, since this deed drives one away from the kingdom of heaven, as the earlier warning regarding this, laid down in the part which deals with this prohibition, provides. He said to cut off the act of lust in order to eliminate the evil desire and to reach the kingdom of heaven. The same can also be deduced from these words, which are written in the Gospel according to Matthew, Mark, and Luke. I promise you, there is no one who will leave his wife for the sake of the kingdom of heaven, and who will not receive in compensation many times double in this world, and in the world to come, everlasting life. Third part, marriage permitted, as we have seen, to the one who finds himself in the preceding two conditions, is permitted in order that he may not be burned by the fire of concupiscence. It is permitted to the one who is not free from concupiscence. And this is evidenced by the words of the apostles who said, If thou wantest to marry, it is not a sin. And if a virgin marries a man, there is not equally sin upon her. Marriage is honored everywhere, and the marriage bed is free from stain. But marriage subsequent to a vow of chastity is a shameful thing. Whosoever has made a vow to preserve his chastity shall observe its terms. Otherwise, he shall be condemned as one who marries two women simultaneously. So far, we have dealt with marriage concluded with the first woman. Marriage to a second woman is different. It is inferior to the first. With respect to the second wife, it is prescribed in the canons that she shall not have the nuptial blessings, but upon her the penitential prayer shall be said. If the turtle dove, which is not rational, abstains from a second marriage, the more suitable will it be for man, the rational animal, to abstain. As a second marriage is not commendable for this reason, this law must be observed. In fact, the second marriage lowers the honored, namely the priest, from their honor. It is a despicable thing in them. A third marriage is despicable, and beyond this, there is no lawful marriage among us. Taking a second or third wife, in addition to the lawful one, is not allowed, because it is manifest fornication, as already said, and as appears from what has already been said on the purposes of marriage. After marriage is performed, the said carnal union must not take place except to remove the trouble of concupiscence, or to have offspring who please God and serve Him. It is also clear that it is not proper for a person to become betrothed if it is known through his character, manifested by his conduct, his temper and intelligence, and his ability to overcome the evil thoughts which originate in him as a consequence of the troubles of concupiscence, that he has a tendency towards a life of chastity, and if, having been overcome by concupiscence, he in turn extinguishes it and keeps it under his control. The bulk of the contents of this chapter is excerpted from the canons known as Aptilicet, and is in the first 11 chapters, and you must know that the ends of marriage are those three which have been mentioned, and which are according to the deeds of the wise and highest Creator, and according to the deeds of His servants who followed Him. We have never found one of them who desired the law of marriage for any reason but the intention to beget offspring. And if a man copulates with his wife after her pregnancy becomes evident, this is not proper. He is not allowed to do so. And one who desires her during her pregnancy must desire her for mutual help only. If it is definitely known that someone fell into that in which there is no union, he must hear his admonition. Marriage, as regards the intention of those who want to use it to attain other ends, is of several kinds. There is the one who desires marriage only for carnal pleasure, as has been mentioned, and does not wish other than this. He wants neither the procreation of offspring nor reciprocal help. There is also the one who sets about preventing conception and pregnancy on his side or on the side of his wife. He is interested in the act of copulating with her solely to derive carnal pleasure and bears with patience because of her beauty, his wife's poverty, and the low stock of her family. The intention of these people, however, becomes good after a long time. There is also the one who desires marriage because of his wife's great wealth or high honor, to boast of the relationship or to show himself off in the company of his wife's family. And for any of these reasons, there are some who tolerate the ugliness of their wives for the sake of wealth, or who do not mind the low stock of their family. There are others who marry women because of the honor which their family enjoys and do not mind their poverty or the foolishness of their family. There is the one whose prudent parent or whose magistrate or some such person arranges his marriage while he is still young to prevent the competition of another for the special beauty of the woman or because of the concupiscence of her wealth, the honor of her relatives, her ornaments, or her intelligence. He does not want this woman to escape his son. He does this also to prevent the trouble of concupiscence, which causes the corruption of the young, and to shield his son from evil desires, or because of the eagerness of a mother who is going to die to be pleased by the marriage of her son for one moment at least, desiring to see it before her death, or before she falls into poverty. Or he may do this just to spite someone, or from motives of rivalry, or from a desire for dominance. Some desire offspring with a good intention, and that is to have a child who will succeed them if they own much wealth. We cannot find among the aforesaid categories any who marry with an intention to abstain from carnal pleasure, nor can we find another category which is not linked with this pleasure and which does not adhere to it. Many conceal their desire for the pleasure of concupiscence, feigning that they search only for mutual help to provide food. And behold, a wise man has found the interpretation of this by saying that concupiscence is the mother of cowardice, fatigue, misery, and ignorance. Truly, it is the mother of sorrow to the layman and clergyman, since it entails many desires which are not actually necessary and makes them necessary. Let us pray to God that He give us harmony, help, strength, and mercy. Amen. Section 2. Promise of Marriage. It is in four parts. First part, betrothal is not good for someone whose intention to marry is not clear. Second part, if the person who is to be betrothed is not indisputably under the authority of another, he may arrange his betrothal personally, or by writing a letter, or with the help of someone whom he would like to be an intermediary. The declaration of betrothal may be made by himself, by means of a letter, or by the person whom he wishes to be an intermediary. Third part. Let us first mention the prohibited forms of marriage so that no one may fix the dowry and the betrothal for them. This subject is divided into 15 parts. Part 1. Marriage between blood relatives, even if they are not relatives by lawful marriage, is forbidden. Blood relatives are of three kinds. A. Ascendants, such as parents, grandparents, and those who follow in an ascendant line. B. Descendants, such as children and children's children who follow a descendant line. C. Collaterals, such as father's brothers and sisters, mother's brothers and sisters, brothers, and children of brothers. These are also related and interrelated because they are born from the same parents and grandparents. And Christians on this matter hold two different opinions. According to the first opinion, marriage is prohibited until the third degree and is permitted from the fourth degree onwards. Those who adhere to this are the Copts, the Nestorians, and a part of the Syrians. And that is pursuant to the canons of the apostles, since these canons did not prohibit marriage from the fourth degree, and to the canons of the Council of Nicaea, which agree on this with the canons of the apostles, and especially the canons of the kings. None of the said canons prohibits marriage from the fourth degree. They do not prohibit it at all. This law is left to the chief priest, who may loosen the bind according to the judgment which promotes utility and do not conflict with the laws. It is provided in the last chapter, that they are permitted to do this. And when they saw that they were dominated by and were fewer than the greater number of non-Christians in their country, so much so that there was no young men and young women from the seventh degree onwards in which marriage is permitted, and that this caused at least corruption of the purity of those overcome by concupiscence, and that there were some who transgressed until they left religion because of this, then they deemed marriage from the fourth degree onwards good and permissible. The second opinion is that marriage between relatives in the sixth degree must be forbidden, and that marriage must be allowed only from the seventh degree onwards. Others forbade marriage until the sixth generation and permitted the seventh. These are the Melkites, who followed the rules laid down by the fourth book of Aptalus. These rules provide that even if the relationship is of the fourth degree or more removed up to the sixth degree, it is not permitted to marry. Thus, marrying children of one's paternal uncle is not permitted. This was said in the canon of their particular council, which canon is found with them. When some of them saw what happened to them because of the impurity which was among them and which was mentioned above, they told the chiefs who were ruling over the country. The chiefs permitted them to marry in the sixth degree, and they preserved thus until the present, but did not benefit from it. They fell into such perdition that because of this, some of them married those who were not in agreement with them in faith. The degrees of relationship used in marriage are calculated as follows. The daughter of a paternal uncle in the fourth degree is like saying, my father begot me, my grandfather begot my father, and these are two degrees. My grandfather begot the brother of my father, and the brother of my father begot his daughter, and that makes four degrees. Part 2. Marriage of relatives by law is not allowed. These relatives are those who, as godparents, sponsor someone else's children at baptism. The godparent and the godchild may not marry each other, nor may they marry the other's parents, according to the canon of the kings. Neither his brother, nor his children, nor the children of his children, nor the children of his wife, nor the children of anyone of them may marry the children of the other. The woman shall not give her daughter in marriage to the man whom her own husband sponsored at baptism, nor shall the man give his daughter in marriage to the man whom his wife sponsored at baptism. Between all these, there is a spiritual relationship, and anyone who does this will be considered an idolater and a sinner until he separates himself from the other partner and does penance for his sin. Those who are not mentioned here are permitted to marry. And about the marriage of the sponsors at baptism, a provision has been made on which there are conflicting views and which is not observed. It runs thus. There shall be no marriage between them and their children, and the only forgiveness for this spiritual sin is obtained by separating and doing penance. Their penance must consist in embracing monastic life if they wish the salvation of their souls. Part 3. Marriage of relatives by dwelling. Even when they are no longer under the authority of those who brought them up, and even when the latter are separated, is not permitted. There are those who were weaned by one breast, or were brought up as one's children, and their children and parents, be they their fathers, or the fathers of their fathers, the brothers of their fathers, and the brothers of their mothers, and sisters of their mothers, or the wife of their father. Never shall the father marry the woman who is like his daughter and was brought up near him. This paternity exists in the following situations. If my grandfather brought up a girl whom my father called his sister, she is my aunt by virtue of having been brought up with my father. Or if my mother nursed a girl and brought her up with me, she is my sister by dwelling. This is found in the canons of the kings. As for the book of the Didascalia, in the 18th rule, it commands that a man should marry a boy whom he brought up as his son to an orphan. This is an act of humility and mercy on his part, and is fitting and good. It is also written in the Canons of the Kings, Part 4. Marriage between relatives by affinity, other than that by consanguinity, is not allowed. These are the fathers and the grandfathers, wives and their sisters, their mothers and their grandmothers, the brothers and their sons' wives, their sisters, their mothers, and their grandmothers, and the relatives of the wife who are who, her grandmother, her mother, her father's sister, her mother's sister, her daughter, and her son's daughter, and the wives of her relatives who are in this degree. And each marriage forbidden to the wife because of affinity is also prohibited to her husband. Part 5. Marriage of the guardian to the woman whom he is charged to settle in marriage and whose property he is appointed to keep is not allowed. Neither the guardian, his son, nor his brother may marry the ward until the ward attains the age of 26 years and the guardian discharges his duty of accounting for her property. Part 6. It is not good for the wife of the master marrying the slave her husband manumitted. Part 7. Marriage of a member of the faithful with one who is an unbeliever and has no part with him is not allowed, since he would add sin to his deeds of perfection. Part 8. Every impediment to the carnal union necessary in marriage is an impediment to marriage. This may be a natural impediment, as with a eunuch from the mother's womb, that is, he who by nature cannot accomplish the mentioned carnal union, a hermaphrodite who has the shameful parts of both the male and the female together in one place, and a woman who has an added bone which hinders union. As for impediments which come after birth, they are of three kinds. One is the case of a eunuch, the second is that of an insane man who is deficient in intelligence, and the third is the case of disabling disease like sores. As for leprosy, let it be left to the choice of the one affected by it. And we have mentioned the provisions of this part in the chapter which deals with the annulment of marriage. Part 9. Marrying a woman who has been condemned justly for adultery and has been divorced with good cause is not allowed. It is said in the canons of the kings, no one is permitted to marry in haste a woman divorced because of adultery. But it is necessary to wait until she does penance, until her penance is well known, and until her neighbors bear witness for her. It is then permitted to marry her, not, however, in the presence of many priests, but before only a priest, and not before a bishop. Part 10. Uniting with two or more women in marriage simultaneously is forbidden. Part 11. The fourth marriage and onwards is prohibited. Part 12. Marrying nuns is prohibited. Part 13. Marrying a woman who has passed her 60th year is prohibited, forbidden. Part 14. It is not allowed to marry a woman who has not completed the time of mourning for the death of her husband, which is a full year or 10 months from his death. The man who marries before this time elapses is barred from the inheritance of his late wife, and the woman from that of her late husband. Each is barred from inheriting what was bequeathed to him and to her. This period impedes marriage, but not betrothal and proposal, but let it be with prayer. Part 15. In case a man and a woman do not consent to a marriage arranged by another, or if the consent is extracted with violence, that is, if any kind of constraint is used, such a marriage is forbidden. This is divided into two parts. First, a tutor may not betroth a ward without the latter's consent, nor shall there be marriage, unless there is the consent of the two who marry and of those under whose tutelage they stay. A defect in the consent of the tutor impedes marriage and the prayer of wedding, but not the betrothal and the proposal. Second, neither the chief of a country, its judges, the sons of the chief, nor any of his men shall bring about the betrothal of any of the women of that country by taking them away by force. It is the same if the girl has not reached the age of womanhood, but this does not impede proposal and betrothal. Fourth part. If the betrothed couple wishes to embrace the monastic life after the dowry has been given, the man shall retake what he has already given to his betrothed, and she shall return what she took without redoubling it. Betrothal and proposal come before marriage in order to make certain that consent is given after perfect counsel and to make possible an inquiry into each other's character during the length of time they agreed upon. This length of time is also established so that their love may be strengthened with consent, so that the young man on whom they agreed may be preserved until he attains manhood. so that he may be the first to have her, so that the hope of a pure marriage may help the preserving of purity, and so that during this interval he may turn his attention to preparing whatever is necessary for the marriage, may fortify his desire for the union, and may follow the teaching of the wise Creator, praise be to him, who said, "It is not well that man remain alone, but let us make him a helpmate of his own kind." He made the promise, and then he did what he promised. Section 3, Betrothal. It is divided into three parts. First part, the definition of betrothal and the precepts concerning it. 1. Betrothal is a pact and promise which precedes marriage. It may be performed either by means of a letter or without any writing, and the pact is made conclusive as follows. The couple must conclude the betrothal in the presence of two elder priests, who shall impose their hands on them, bless them with the cross which seals their union, and place rings on their fingers. The betrothal shall be arranged and registered, as shall be the consent of the future spouses and the consent of the tutor. As for the girl who is under tutelage, if her tutor wishes to betroth her to one who is unfit and harmful for her, she may refuse even if the tutor cannot take back his word. And the children of those who are demented in intelligence, even if they have a tutoress, may not need the consent of their father when they are to be married, nor at their betrothal. This, however, will depend on the decision of the judge. Marriage without outfit and dowry is permitted. The woman who is in mourning for her late husband shall not be prevented from betrothal. One who is not beyond 7 years shall not be betrothed. And if a person is betrothed but has not fixed specifically when the marriage will take place, the period shall be 2 years. If he is present in the country, if he is traveling far, the interval shall be 3 years. If betrothal extends beyond this period, the betrothed girl may be given to another in marriage, but the lapse of time shall be 4 years if there is an evident reason, such as sickness, debts to be paid off, an offense punishable with death, or a distant journey because of difficulty. A father may break the betrothal of a daughter who is under his authority, but not that of one who is independent. The guardian cannot break the betrothal of the one who is already promised. If those to be married are orphans who have not attained majority, if none of them has a father, a mother, or a guardian, and if they arrange the betrothal themselves before witnesses and later repent, they shall remain betrothed until they reach the age of 15 years. If one cannot maintain the other because of inability to fulfill his duties as husband or wife, when they attain this age, being in full possession of the reason, they shall be permitted to do what they like, to unite in marriage or to separate. As for the young woman who is under the tutelage of her parents or is independent, if a man betrothed her, she gave her consent and they ate and drank together. But if after this an overbearing person took her and carried her away by force or deceit and had carnal intercourse with her, the woman must return to her intended spouse, provided that he accepts her again. If he refuses to, the overbearing person must marry her if he has no wife. In the canons of the Epiphanius and others, it is said, "He who commits fornication with a young girl shall not marry her unless her first betrothed leaves her, if she is already betrothed. But if she was not betrothed, the case shall be settled pursuant to the choice of her family. After this, the overbearing person shall be forced to marry her even if she is poor and ugly." Second part, the earnest given at betrothal. Earnest is given at betrothal if the one who took it refuses and breaks the agreement of marriage after he has taken it, he shall return double of what he took. And if the one who gave the earnest breaks the agreement of marriage, he shall forfeit the earnest. But if death occurs, there are two opinions regarding it. The first, and this is, if the marriage was not delayed by the fault of the deceased, the survivor shall return what he took. And the second, which is more valid, is, if the woman dies, the future spouse shall recover what he gave her from her family, except the food and drinks he provided. But if the man who owns the dowry is dead and has no heir, she will keep what she took, since she deserves it more than the others. She lost her husband, she being a young betrothed girl. But if the deceased has heirs, they shall take back half of his property for themselves, and she shall keep the other half, because the marriage was certain to be concluded. Whatever was decided upon during the lifetime of the father and was agreed to by him shall not be changed. If the father of the young girl or her mother received the earnest, or if her grandfather received it for her, who is the daughter of his son, and if both the betrothed parties have attained marriageable age, double the earnest shall be given back if they refuse to celebrate the marriage while it was possible to do so. But if it was not possible for them, they shall give back the earnest without doubling it. And the same rule be applied to the master of a young girl who has power over her and has taken earnest. Majority for the man is reached when the completion of the 20th or 25th year of age, and for the woman with the 12th or 15th year of age. As for terminating the authority of the one who has been appointed as their guardian, they shall ask the judge to rid them of the tutelage, so that they may administer their affairs and their property themselves to their best advantage, since they are capable of administering their affairs and their property. And the judge shall testify to this. From then onwards, they shall do whatever appeals to them by consulting each other. In case a betrothal is definitely arranged, the earnest for the marriage has been given, and the betrothed refuses to unite with their partner because of his bad nature, because of his many faults, because he violates the law, breaking it by following the dictates of his mind, because he is one who cannot have a union with her, that union which is useful for procreating children, or because of other reasons which are truly impeding. In all these cases, if there are witnesses concerning this, that this woman and her parents knew all this before taking the earnest, they shall blame none but themselves. But if they were ignorant when they received the earnest at the time of the betrothal, or if after they received the earnest any reasons which justifies the withdrawal appears, double shall be demanded from them when they return it. Third part, the presents given before marriage. The presents a man gave before the marriage shall be delivered back to him if the marriage is not celebrated. But if the man himself refuses to marry the woman of his own will, he shall lose his earnest and all the presents he gave to her. And if the woman refuses to marry him, she shall give back whatever she has of the earnest, and shall return the presents he gave her, just as she did with the earnest. The presents are those given for betrothal and not for marriage. As there are presents to be given on the day of marriage, they shall belong to her, if the woman is in her own house, because she is the betrothed of one who betrothed her a long time before. If she is in the house of her intended spouse, the presents belong to the woman, and the creditors of the man shall not take anything from the presents he gave to his betrothed. The woman shall have the right of priority before the creditors of her husband in taking the dowry, but she shall not have priority on previous creditors for the presents given before marriage. Section 4, the duty of the father towards his son concerning marriage. The father shall give on behalf of his son, as he is the lord who accepts on behalf of one who is under his authority. The father may not force his son to marry if the son, being under his authority, wishes to live in purity. But if the son is desolate in his behavior, he cannot refuse to obey the command of his father. If the father decides to give his daughter in marriage, or the daughter of his son, or the daughter of his daughter, and he gives her a wedding outfit according to his means, but she refuses and prefers shameful deeds, she shall be disinherited. Sons must not refuse marriage and thus harm their parents by making them indebted to return the wedding outfit and the presents which they took before marriage. By virtue of their position as parents and as those who give the wedding outfit and presents before marriage, parents are not allowed to break the law of marriage in any respect. The guardian who prevents his wards from marrying by violence stops others from arranging their marriage and does not give them a wedding outfit shall be ordered by the magistrates to have them married and to give them their outfit. As for a woman beyond 25 years of age, if her parents do not care to have her married, she is permitted to apply to the magistrates so that they may command her parents to have her married and to give her an outfit in proportion to their means. But if she is independent and has attained her majority, she may take a husband in the manner permitted by the law, even if her father opposes it. And the same applies to any child, whether male or female. If a prisoner does not return within the period of 3 years, the son may get married. And if the whereabouts of the father and whether he is alive or dead are not known during these 3 years, his children are permitted to marry anyone they like, according to the precept of the law. As for the children of a prisoner or of a traveler, if they marry before the 3 years elapse and it is known that their father would not agree to this relationship, their marriage is not proper. But if their father is without the use of reason, their grandfather's consent is sufficient if he has the use of reason. Otherwise, let it be according to the advice of her family. If there is a dispute with a woman who has attained majority, let it be settled according to the decision of the judge. If the judge gives the same advice as her family did, but the man whom she chose herself is equal in appearance and in deeds to their choice, let it be done as she herself has chosen. If a dispute arises between an orphan girl's relative and her guardian about her marriage, and she has not yet attained womanhood, the decision of the judge shall be followed. And the person who merely administers the property of the orphan has no power in regard to her marriage, either to prevent her from marrying or to give her a husband. Those who are in mourning for the death of their father or grandfather shall not be prevented from marrying during the time of their mourning. Section 5. Definition of marriage and matters concerning it. It is divided into three parts. First part, definition of marriage. This is the consent of man and woman manifested before true witnesses and accompanied by the prayer of the priest to be united, to live in harmony, to provide the means by which they may help each other in providing for their own needs and procreating offspring who will survive them. Second part, the first item regarding marriage. The celebration of marriage shall not take place without the consent of both spouses and of their guardians. Those who marry must have attained the same age of manhood and womanhood. The man must be 20 years old and the woman must be 12 years old. The woman who marries before this is not a wife according to the law, since she does not consent with full knowledge to the union with the man. Those who arrange a marriage must also observe this term of age so that the marriage may be legal, suitable both for the man and for the woman. No wedding shall be performed secretly, without the gathering of many people, but all weddings shall be performed in public. Marriage does not take place and shall not be performed without the participation of priests and a prayer offered over the spouses. The Holy Eucharist shall be given them at the time of the wedding, by which both become united and become but one body, as our Lord, to him be glory, has said, in the absence of this form, one shall not consider them as validly married, since it is the prayer which hands over the woman to the man and the man to the woman. Third part, the section on marriage and what follows it. There are 11 parts. 1. The first is dealt with in 5 parts. The first part deals with the first marriage and has been dealt with in the first section. The second part is about the second marriage. Men are permitted to marry a second time without coronation. If they have small children, they must safeguard the inheritance of the children got from their late mother, since it is not proper for them to abandon their own children. If the men who contract the second marriage are priests, they shall be deposed from their degree. If they contract a third marriage, they shall be considered impure. As for those who marry after taking the vow, they transgress the law, not because of the union, but because they have lied to their creator. The widow who has passed the 60th year of age and marries a second time shall be expelled because she is a fornicatress. A woman is bound by the law as long as her husband lives, but if her husband dies, she is at liberty and may marry anyone she wishes from among the believers in God. Blessed is she if she remains according to my counsel, but if she cannot endure, let her marry. If those who marry are widowers, the nuptial blessing shall be said over them, since this blessing is bestowed upon the virgin man and woman during their marriage. If they marry a second time, the prayer of absolution shall be said over them by the priest. If one of the spouses is a virgin, only that person shall receive the nuptial blessing. This law applies equally to men and women. One from among the widows who marries and has children must give power over the properties of their father to her children before she remarries, and must give them a share of her own property. If she has attained 25 years of age, she has authority to dispose of herself in her own right as she wishes. If she wants to marry for the second time, however, she must do so with the advice of her father. But if he is dead, she shall marry according to the advice of her relatives, and if her relatives object to her choice, it is better that both the betrothed go to the governor so that he may settle this question, as seems proper to him. If the prospective husband chosen by her relatives and the other chosen by the young woman are equal regarding family and condition, let it be settled according to her wish. Third part. On third marriages. The third marriage is a sign of depravity, and if one can, one must avoid it. The one who marries for a third time is a dirty vessel in the church. Fourth part. If more than a third marriage is contracted, it is a sign of manifest fornication. If someone dares to contract a fourth marriage, which is not a true marriage, it shall not be considered as a lawful marriage. Those who are born from this marriage shall not be considered as worthy and well known. Those who marry for the fourth time shall be subjected to the punishment inflicted upon the lewd for fornication, and shall be separated from one another. Fifth part. A man shall not have two wives, for this pleasure and the contracting of many marriages serve to gratify concupiscence, and not to beget offspring as God ordered. If one does this, he shall be prevented from receiving the Eucharist and from entering the church. He shall not enter the community of the faithful until he parts from the second woman and lives with the first only. Whether he takes two wives together, or he takes them separately, each one in her own house, or he keeps a wife and a concubine, he shall be deposed from his priesthood if he is a priest, and if he is a layman, he shall be barred from associating with the people. The woman who approaches another man while her husband lives is an adulteress and a transgressor of the law. 2. If a Christian marries an unbelieving woman, he must command her to embrace the faith. Women who are believers must not marry men who are not of the faith, lest the men convert them to their faith and cause them to lose the true faith. If a Christian woman marries a non-Christian man, she shall be expelled from the community. If she repents and leaves him, she shall be accepted by the community as an apostate converted from her impiety. And after she becomes purified, she may stay together with the other faithful and may receive the Eucharist. As for a Christian who gives his daughter or sister away in marriage to an unbeliever, and that too against their will, or when they do not know that the man is an unbeliever, he shall be expelled from the community and shall not be allowed to stay together with the faithful. But the daughter of the sister shall not be expelled. If he repents and separates her from the unbeliever, a penance proportionate to his capacity to support it shall be given to him, and then he shall be forgiven. If there is any brother in the faith who has a wife who does not believe, and she consents to dwell with him, let him not send her away. And if any believing woman has a non-believing husband, and he consents to dwell with her, she shall not separate from her husband, for the unbelieving husband is sanctified by the believing wife, just as the unbelieving wife is sanctified by the believing husband. But if the unbeliever wishes to separate, let them be separated. 3. The length of time during which one of the couple is not permitted to remarry after the death of the other. There are two opinions about this. The first is, no one is allowed to remarry before the lapse of 1 year from the death of his wife. If he marries before the lapse of 1 year, he shall be deprived of all the property left by his wife to which he was entitled. The second is, if a woman marries a man before the lapse of 10 months from the death of her husband, nothing shall be given to her from what he bequeathed to her. If he left her a legacy, she shall not take it. She shall not be honored like other respectable women. 4. As for the woman, If after her marriage, her husband becomes poor because he gave presents and dowry before the marriage, and if she wants to take what she received from him, she shall not be allowed to do so, but must maintain her husband and her children with her dowry. 5. If a man pledges the property of his wife without her consent, taking the pledge is not allowed. If the wife consents that her husband pledged her property, offering no objection, but later on brings an action against her husband by invoking the help of others, she has no right to such help. The law helps a good woman and not an evil one. 6. On the prohibition of divorcing a wife in the absence of a cause sufficient to annul a marriage. This prohibition is in conformity with the gospel according to Matthew, which bears witness by saying, "And there came to the Lord Jesus the Pharisees, tempting him and saying, Is it right for a man to send away his wife for whatever cause? He answered and said to them, Have you never read that from the beginning God created them male and female? And he said, For this cause shall a man leave his father and his mother, and shall cleave to his wife, and they two shall be one flesh. What God has joined together, let no man put asunder. Why then, they said, did Moses command to give a bill of divorce and to send her away? He said to them, Moses, indeed, by reason of the hardness of your heart, has written to you to send away your wives, but from the beginning of the creation it was not so. And I say to you that whosoever sends away his wife, except it be for fornication, he makes her an adulteress. And the one who marries her, who is sent away by her husband, commits adultery. And the Apostle Paul has said in his turn, Let every man stay with his own wife, and every woman stay with her own husband. And he also said, And to those who are married, not I command them, but it is God's precept that the wife depart not from her husband. And if she wishes to depart, she must stay without husband, or otherwise she must be reconciled to her husband. As for the man, he shall not send away his wife. If thou, O man, art bound to thy wife, do not wish to be loosed from her. 7. Prohibition against refusing to give the conjugal debt owed to each other. The man must give the love which is due to his wife from him, and the woman shall do the same with her husband. The wife has no power over her body, but the husband has power over her. By the same token, the husband has no power over his own body, but the wife has power over him. None of you shall refuse to another the love which is due to him, except by mutual consent, for a time, that you may give yourselves to fasting and prayer, and then, when you have fulfilled this, return to your will again, lest Satan tempt you for want of your mutual love. I say this to you as one says to the weak, not as a strict commandment. 8. The days on which husband and wife are not permitted to have carnal union. It is said in the canons of the kings that they forbade the marital union of parents whose son had been baptized in the daytime or at night in honor of the Holy Spirit. Do not stain the holy days of fasting, and do not approach your wife on the days of her menstruation and childbed, lest your marriage become unlawful. Remember what God has commanded you by the mouth of Moses when he said, Speak to the children of Israel and tell them, If any man approaches a woman in her menstruation, they shall be destroyed and shall die without child, because they have not respected the pure seed when they have injected it into the blood of her menstruation. And for these things it has been commanded that the man must die without child. Woe to him who commits this sin during the Holy Week. The marriage which God has ordained for mankind is not only for procreation, but also for desires which are not forbidden. God has established the times in which one must refrain from, and the times in which one may fulfill his own pleasure, but it shall not be done with impurity. The conjugal act in the days of menstruation and childbed of a woman is prohibited because the genital organ is spoiled thereby, and because leprosy befalls the children conceived in the womb during menstruation as a consequence of this thing. Gloss 21. It is in the canons of the kings, sores and leprosy befall them. The prohibition is imposed on fasting days in order that one may fulfill the desire which must be obtained through fasting, which is the restraining of the animal soul from animal concupiscence. in honor of the rational soul which is united with it in accordance with its spiritual nature. It is necessary that each one abstain in the days of the spoiling blood in order to safeguard his own body and his children. And in the Holy Week one must abstain because these are the days of mourning, of fasting, and of abundant prayer, day and night. As for the other fast, if there is one who is overcome by a fiery concupiscence against which he cannot fight, he has to extinguish it and to take away the harm which it brings. At night time, during which eating and drinking are permitted, except the night which precedes the day on which receiving the Eucharist is commanded. 9. Prohibition against shedding the seed outside the uterus of the woman. This prohibition is based on the books and on reason. The first, because the primary end of marriage is the leaving of offspring, as we explained clearly before. Taking a wife with the intention to deviate the seed or to do similar things becomes a deed in which what one seeks is not obtained. The one who would marry with this in mind must not take a wife. The second, because of the word of God who said in the law that one who lies down with a woman and removes his seed from her shall not escape from death. And when Onan, the son of Judah, and this evil deed was intended to destroy those who exist united with his brother's wife, he spilled the seed upon the ground, as the book says. His deed was despicable, detestable before God, and he slew him. And Chrysostom said in his explanation of the gospel according to Matthew, they set about avoiding the natural fruit, and this is worse than destroying those who exist. And this evil is attained by giving the seed and sending it where it will not become seed, or by using poison in order to prevent conception. 10. On one who accuses his wife of depravity. If a man among you marries a woman, has intercourse with her, and afterwards hates her without reason, and says, I have found her not to be a virgin. And if her father rises and takes action against him and finds that the man accused her falsely, the man shall be reproached for his deed and punished for his sin. She shall be his wife whether he is willing or would refuse her, and never shall he be separated from her until the death of one of them. But if what he charged her with is true, and her virginity is found lacking, and if her parents were not aware of her shame is known, and her shame is known, they shall be separated. She shall be cursed, and shall not be married to another, but shall dwell in her house with sorrow and weeping, since she fornicated in her father's house and dishonored him. If a man who has been told by people that his wife has committed adultery knows not the truth about this and desires to know the truth about her deed, he shall bring her before the judge of God's church and place her before the altar. The priest shall take an earthen vessel into which he shall pour bitter sulphurous water. He shall take a little earth from the corner of the altar, cast it into the water, and take the vessel into his hands. She shall unveil her head, and the priest shall make her take an oath in the power of the Holy Ark and the ever-present Holy Spirit by saying, has a strange man committed adultery with you? If she answers no, the priest shall say to her, if you are pure of what your husband suspects, drink this water, and no evil shall harm you. But if you have been foolish and have sworn falsely, let the curse of God be upon you, and may you be taken a slave far from your family. Let this water you drink spoil all your body and dissolve all your members, and let your body be dissolved forever. The woman shall say, Amen, Amen, Amen. She shall drink the water before the altar of God, with her head unveiled and observed by her husband. If she is a liar, the water she drank will swell all her body, and she will become an example to everybody who looks upon her. But if she is innocent, no evil will befall her, and she will conceive and give birth to a male child, of whom she rejoices. God will make disappear from her husband the suspicion and the jealousy he had entertained against her. 11. The knowledge of these things which lead to an understanding of marriage. Based on this knowledge, none must think that marriage is prohibited in itself and in its essential actions. The one who abstains from marriage, thinking that it is impure, is foolish, because everything God created is very good. Since God created males and females for good and beauty, the one who thus abstains then shall be excluded from the church. But if he abstains to serve God and for the sake of purity, he may abstain. One who despises the law of true marriage and says that contracting it is an impure thing which prevents one from entering the kingdom of heaven shall be excommunicated. One who leaves his wife and wishes her to leave him because he considers marriage as an impure thing shall be excommunicated. It is not allowed for a woman in menstruation or in childbirth or a midwife to enter the church during the times of which mention is made hereafter. A woman in menstruation shall not enter the church, nor shall she receive the Eucharist until the days of her menstruation are over, even if she is the wife of the king. And if any priest transgress this, he shall be deposed from his rank. A woman who gave birth shall stay outside the holy place for 40 days if the newborn is male. But if she gave birth to a female, she shall stay outside for 80 days. The midwife shall not receive the holy mysteries until 20 days after the birth of males and 40 days in the case of females. And the midwives shall also keep themselves apart from adulterous women. As for the woman who has a husband, if she commits adultery, but her husband is unaware thereof, only she must be punished. But if her husband is aware of it and refuses to drive her away, both shall be driven away from the church. And if he is a priest, he shall be deposed from his rank and prevented from taking the holy mysteries. If after deposition from his rank he does penance and drives away the woman, let him receive the holy mysteries, but he shall not be restored to his rank, since he has been the companion of an adulteress. If the wife of a priest marries another after the death of her husband, she must do penance, since she has done a shameful thing and has debased his previous rank. Section 6. The marriage which may be dissolved. Marriage may be dissolved on 3 grounds. First, if husband and wife choose a religious life as monk and nun by mutual consent. The second is the will of one of the spouses, that is, if one refuses to part the partner, the marital union, the performing of carnal union, which is the end of marriage, for the reason mentioned above. Okay, I'm going to try that again. The second is the will of one of the spouses, that is, if one refuses to partner the marital union, the performing of carnal union, which is the end of marriage, for the reasons mentioned in Part 8 on the impediments to marriage. For in this case, the first end of marriage, which is to have offspring, is not attained by such a marriage. In such a case, the one shall refuse to the other the marital union, nor is the end which follows it, which is the removal of the burden of concupiscence in the way not prohibited by law. In addition to the above, a lack of news for many years concerning one of the spouses due to his imprisonment or some similar cause may constitute a further ground for dissolving the marriage. The third concerns the marriage in which another end of it is not attained. This end is the mutual help that renders life less burdensome and more agreeable. This point is divided into 3 parts. 1. In reference to one of the spouses, if a man persists in adultery with a woman known before or after his marriage, or if he falls into sin with another woman, the marriage is dissolved. 2. Adultery is not permitted, as demonstrated before. This is for 2 good reasons. First, adultery is not permitted because of the damage resulting to the lives of the married couple, because of lack of food, of mutual care, and of affection for their children. Their lifelong concern and interest are constantly directed to that which is opposed to their good, and their property is granted to strangers. Second, adultery is forbidden because of the man's uncertainty about his own offspring. One not born to him might be his heir, and one born from an adulterous union might not be heir to his true father. Adultery is forbidden also lest the killing of one of the partners, or indeed of the seducer, be occasioned by jealousy, or lest the killing of the one who devises the marriage of one of the adulterers happen. 3. If there is damage to the life of one of the couple by the other, and their quarrel results in bitter violence involving enmity, the marriage is dissolved. For these 3 cases, 3 canons have been established. The first is this. The marriage is dissolved if husband and wife become monks by mutual agreement. Second, The marriage is dissolved because of difficulty, that is, if the husband is unable to perform carnal union with his wife and to do that which is proper to his nature. He shall stay with her, however, until 3 years after the attempted desires. Then the wife and her relatives are permitted to dissolve their union. If it is the woman who does not want to dwell with him, she shall give the man her dowry if he desires to retake it from her. The presents given before marriage shall remain with the man, who shall not give anything on his part. If a man who married a woman found her wanting in feminine nature, of a structure different from a woman's nature and not suitable for a man, and if he has made this known on the first day of his contract with her, or on the second or third day, and acquainted the priest with her case, he is free from any responsibility. When the facts are well ascertained, the bishop must separate them, dissolve their marriage, and give permission to the man to marry again. The woman shall be reproached and forbidden to marry. So also her master shall be reproached, excluded from the Eucharist, and forbidden to enter the church for many days. But if the husband was unaware of and kept her condition hidden, and dared to do a shameful thing by attempting to unite with her for many days, and then her condition is known, he shall be reproached. If he is one of those who are chaste and follow the way of purity, he shall not be permitted to marry. But if he is one who, it is feared, may commit shameful acts worse than what he has performed, let him be married. If one of the couple is thrown to earth by the devil, two opinions are held regarding him. The first is, if a husband finds his wife thrown to earth by the devil, where this is a new thing after her marriage with him, and she has cohabited with him for a long time, he must bear with her and have patience. If a similar thing befell him, she ought to bear with him and have patience, and never should she be permitted to marry another. But if she suffered from this thing while she was betrothed, before marrying him, her condition was kept secret from the man, and he was unaware thereof. If he wishes to be rid of her, let his marriage be dissolved, and let him marry another woman. The dowry, the outfit, and whatever she brought to him from her father's house shall belong to her. If she has brought with her beast, let her also take the price. For those which are dead, he has no responsibility. And of the calves born to these beasts, all the profit made from them and from their wool, and all the children of the men and women slaves, half shall go to her, and the other half to her husband. This is in case he wishes to divorce her. If there is a man who has a dispute with his wife arising out of these things, if he has consumed something from her outfit, she shall take in compensation the equivalent value. But in the case he has made some donation from his property in her favor, she shall not give it to her, but it shall belong to him. The second opinion is in, if the sickness which makes her fall has come upon her after she married him, and if he wishes to divorce her, she shall take the dowry and the outfit. But if the sickness has come upon her before he married her, and he was not aware of it, if he wants to be separated from her, he shall give her all the outfit, and what he ascribed to her from his property shall belong to him. If leprosy befalls one of the couple, there are two opinions. First, if the leprosy befalls one of them after their marriage, and one of them wills to separate from the other, he may not do so. Second, this opinion is more just. If one marries a woman and after the marriage a sickness like sores or leprosy comes upon her, if he wishes to separate from her, he must give her the full outfit and the dowry. But if he does not wish to separate from her, he may let her live with him on the condition that he provide her with food at his own expense according to his means, since what befell her was not by her or his will. We ordered the dissolution of the marriage of one who is in jail, but until one knows whether he will be released or not, the man and the woman shall remain husband and wife. We order that the union be kept intact until its accomplishment. There shall not be another marriage either for woman or for men, and if they dare to violate this rule, they shall be punished. The man shall be deprived of the presents given prior to the marriage, and the woman shall be deprived of the dowry and the wedding outfit. In case it is not known whether a man is living in the hands of the enemy or not, then the man or the woman shall wait 5 years. After this period of time, if his death is ascertained, or if he is absent, or if he has disappeared into distant lands, marriage is permitted without any hesitation. It is evident that marriage is permitted after waiting 5 years, even if ransom for his release has been given, but he does not come. If the man is among the soldiers of the king, we order that one wait for the 2 years that the expedition lasts, that wives wait even when they receive no letter or news from their husbands. If one of them receives news that her husband is dead, we must not permit her to marry unless she herself or her parents or others ask and ascertain the truth of the news from the chiefs in whose service her husband was employed. If he is dead, the gospel shall be put before them in the presence of witnesses, and after the certainty of his death is confirmed, let the woman have a document of permission in which the witnesses are mentioned. Then she shall wait for one more year, after which she may contract a legal marriage. If she dares to transgress this, she and the one who marries her shall be punished with the punishment meted out to fornicators. Those who testify that her husband was dead, if they gave false evidence, shall be deposed from their rank and shall pay 10 pounds of gold to be given to the person as to whose death they falsely testified. Then that man may do what he likes. If he wishes that she return to him, he may take his wife back. This third part is further subdivided into 3 sections. The first deals with adultery committed by a woman. If the man knows that he can produce reliable testimony against his wife to the effect that she committed adultery, he must first produce the witnesses, and then he may divorce her. The man shall take double her dowry with the presents given before marriage. If he has no children, he shall take the third part of his wife's outfit from her property. If he has children from her, the outfit and the rest of her property shall be kept for her children. And when the fact of adultery is discovered in her, he and she shall be punished together. As for the adulterer who has sinned with a man's wife, the value of the outfit which the woman's father gave her before at the time of marriage shall be taken from him. If the adulterer has a wife, she shall take her dowry with the presents given to her before marriage. If there are children, the wife shall have only the use thereof, and the property shall be preserved for their children. The profits derived from the dowry and the presents which are in the man's possession after the fact of adultery, we order to be given to the children. As for the presents given before the marriage, we order that they be assigned to the woman if there are no children, and what remains of the property shall be in common. The second section deals with what must be done with an adulteress. This is a woman who drinks against the advice of her husband with another man, or bathes, or jokes, or goes to a hunting place, or to a gathering while her husband is absent, or who passes the night out of her home in another house. All these are acts sufficient grounds to dissolve the marriage. Unless the woman passed the night in her father's house, unless because she had no father, she had to pass the night in someone else's house, or unless the fact is in harmony with the dispositions of prohibited marriage made in the previous sections, except the 5th and 6th. And there are a number of other canons besides those mentioned. As for the rest, the provisions laid down above as regards the woman shall apply to the man when something against him is known, since the law applies to both the man and the woman equally. The third section deals with the case in which one of the couple schemes against the life of the other, and in which the man devises against the purity of his wife. If the woman plans to harm the life of her husband in any way, or if she knows that others are planning the same thing and does not bring this to his knowledge, the marriage may be dissolved. If one marries a woman, and between him and her there is enmity or some other cause, and if the one who offended is the woman, the man shall be patient with her and be merciful to her until she repents of her evil ways and returns to the good. if the husband cannot do this, and her evil deeds against him increase, he shall bring her to the senior priest, who shall be the peacemaker between them. If she refuses him, the bishop shall judge between them. If she does not obey even the bishop, and flees far from her husband, the bishop shall bring her back. If she persists and does not listen to his voice and will not enter her home, the bishop shall take his shoes and leave the dust of his feet at her door. Her husband is permitted to do what he likes. If she wants to marry another woman, let him marry. If he desires to remain in his condition and has patience, let him remain in that condition. If he is a good man, let him be a monk. But if it is known from the behavior of the man that the unjust one and the enemy of the woman is himself, and he desires to create enmity towards her so as to be rid of her, no one shall excuse him. He shall be compelled to live together with her. If he refuses and wants to leave his home, he shall be excluded from the Eucharist and forbidden to enter the church. Gloss 22. This is not commanded in our church, but is written only to make it known. The obvious reasons which permit the woman to leave the house of her husband or similar things are: if the husband schemes against the life of the wife in any manner, or if others so plot against her and he knows it and does not make her aware of it, or if he schemes against her purity and gives her to one who sins with her, if there are witnesses against him to prove that he incited her to adultery but did not succeed, certainly this is reason enough for her to leave him and to take her outfit. The presents given her before marriage shall be awarded to her. Gloss 23. His punishment shall not be limited to this only. The woman shall also take something from his remaining property. If she has no children, she shall take 1/3 of the presents given her before marriage. But if she has children from him, we order that all his property be preserved for their children, as well as the remaining property and the presents given before the marriage, which we ordered above, in favor of the woman. Gloss 24. It is right that the punishment for the adultery of the woman be greater than that of the man. This is so established because the adultery of that of the man is such that it is not necessary for the woman to be separated from him, since the main aim of the law is to remove the difficulties which come upon men in their relationships. Also, man especially is so moved by jealousy as to kill his wife if she commits adultery against him, or to kill also the man who has committed adultery with her. And he does this also to her father or her brother or her mother, while the woman and her relatives are not like this. And it is right that the punishment for the adultery of women be greater than that of man, because the lineage is maintained if the woman leads an honest life. If she commits adultery, the descent and the paternal lineage is corrupted. Also, the virgin spoils the form of her virginity by adultery, while for a man this is not so. And in other laws, there are provisions of punishment for a man who accuses his wife of shameful things and cannot prove it through witnesses. To such a man, the same punishment which he had in mind to inflict upon her if she were convicted is to be his. And if a man is found with another woman in the home in which he dwells with his wife, or if a man is united in the city with another woman and has been reproached for having been with her several times, and this charge has been made by the mouth of his parents, or by the parents of his wife, or by the mouth of other reliable witnesses, and if he persists in lying, let the marriage be dissolved. She shall take the outfit which she brought and the presents previous to marriage, and let her take also the third part of the property of the man. In case she has children from him, the woman shall do thus. She shall take what she can get of from the presents given prior to marriage, and the third part of the property of the man who has been reproached, and that owned by him shall be preserved for their children. If she has no children, we order that the ownership of this property belong to her. And about the separation of the man from his wife, there is another appropriate canon, and let one do according to it. As for adulterers, they shall not be separated from their wives, nor shall one who accuses his wife without convicting her, because these are charges which are true, but not susceptible of being proved. And those who have power to forgive, the sin must give punishment for these and similar things as penance, but they must not separate the wife from her husband. Chapter 25, Prohibition of Concubines. Concubine and women with marriage bond. Having a concubine is forbidden in our saintly law, since it is contrary to lawful marriage as clearly explained before. It is continuous fornication. If there is one who has a concubine who is his slave, he must abstain and marry according to the law. If she is a free woman, let him marry her according to the law. If he refuses to do this, let him be expelled. No man shall be permitted to live with a concubine in his house, nor is there any difference between him and fornicators. If he wishes to live with her, he must marry her according to the requirements of a lawful marriage. If he deems her not worthy to be called his legal wife, he must send her away. Instead of her, let him take a woman he likes. If he prefers, let him remain in purity. One who has a wife and has illicit relations with his woman slave shall be punished. The governor must sell her in some other far country. As for the unbeliever concubine of an unbeliever, if she is his slave and is not contaminated with others and has brought up her children, let her enter. But if she is contaminated with others, she must be expelled. It is not right for a man to have a concubine from this time on, since our Lord Jesus Christos has established a law of freedom. If you say that David, Solomon, and others had concubines, and if you want to know the reason, listen. It is because men were scarce at that time on the earth. It has therefore been permitted to them to marry and have concubines, so that men might multiply on the earth. And when the Lord saw that the earth was full, his law forbade taking concubines, and the Lord established the law of marriage. Chapter 26, Donation. The greater part of this chapter is extracted from the book TS, paragraphs 12 and 13 on donations. Donation is composed of five elements, which are the act of donation, the donor, the donee, the thing donated, and other prescriptions. A donation is made in favor of those who are not fit to receive alms, and alms go to those who are fit to receive them. Making a donation is an act of virtue. A donation must be given after the granting of alms. And since the donor has donated and the donee has received the thing which is donated, the donee has power over it and may dispose of it like the donor. As for the donor, his donation is not valid if he has not attained majority and is not wise, free, or distinguished, or has fear of the donee. If he has fear of the donee, the donation is not valid. If the donor dies, the donee shall not draw back, either in secret or in public, from taking the donation with acceptable witnesses. The donor may make the donation if he wishes during his lifetime, without fixing the time. If he wishes the donation to be given at a determined time after his death, as by will, he must make at his death the will which will have effect after his death. If he gives away all his property, or the greater part of it at a time when he has no children, and begets children sometime later, he is permitted to recover his property and give it to whom he wishes. In this matter, whatever he has given away, be it money that is still at hand or the equivalent of the thing donated, he may dispose of as he sees fit. After the death of either the donor or the donee, there shall be restitution neither of the donation nor of its equivalent, should it be no longer available, nor of what the donor may have received from the donee as compensation for the thing he has given, unless an agreement was made between the two. Nor may restitution take place when damage to the donee may occur at the time of restitution, as, for example, when the donor donated a house and the donee constructed a wall. In this case, the latter shall return not the house, but the price of the house. And if one who has not attained majority made a donation to anyone, he must confirm it within 4 years after attaining his majority, or take back whatever he donated if he so desires. A donation made in writing is not conclusive until the donor transfers a written deed to the donee. If it is in favor of the one who is not one of his relatives, the donor cannot claim it from him after transferring it to him. If the donation is in favor of his son or the son of his son, it remains valid without the written deed. He may revoke it while he lives and change what he wrote in their favor as he desires. But after his death, whatever is in the written deed belongs to them, even if he did not transfer the deed to them. As for those to whom donation is made, first of all come children, then parents, relatives, sons-in-law, tutors, friends, servants, faithful neighbors, then companions, and similar persons. There must be equality to the one who should be treated equally, as in the case with children, but there may be one among them who was not grateful to the donor, but ran after wickedness, raised his hand against the donor, unjustly or with malice and fraud, caused a grave loss by accusing him in order to take his property, did something to endanger the donor's life, or failed to fulfill any of the conditions binding him in their agreement made before witnesses regarding whatever the donor has given to him. When it is openly known in the court and is ascertained that the donee has committed one of these acts, the donor can revoke his donation and take back unchanged the thing he donated, if it is at hand, or its price if it is not available. If they do not agree on the price, the word of the donor shall be accepted unless evidence which impeaches it is put forth. If the unworthy donee states that he is poor, this does not hinder the action against him unless there is other evidence which annuls it. The donation has no value unless made to one who has property. It is not perfected until it is received. The thing to be donated must not be unknown, nor such that the donor does not have full ownership of it. And let not the donation be either a thing which the donor is convinced in conscience will develop cupidity in the heart of the donee, or a thing which will do the harm to the donee, such as a sword donated to one possessed by the devil. It may happen that he will kill himself or others with it. If the amount of the money donated is not known at the moment of its passing, as are gold or silver coins, a written deed is not necessary. But if it is known, a deed shall be drawn. There must be the writing of witnesses who mention in it the amount of the money which is donated, its quality, and the detailed conditions made to the donor relating to the donation. The donor shall write therein stating that he will not revoke the donation. If the thing donated is a field, the grain reaped from it belongs to the donee from the time the deed was drawn up in his favor and he took possession thereof, unless it was provided otherwise in the deed. If the thing donated was only the grain which is in the field, he shall not have the field, but shall be deprived of the whole donation. If the donee accepts the field given to him, the thing remains thus. As for other conditions, no condition which conflicts with the perfection of donation shall be laid down. If one makes a donation to another, and the latter dies before he receives it, his heirs cannot take it. If one who is under a tutoress makes a donation with the authorization of his father, or of his own free will, that donation must be considered as one made by the father. If one donates something to someone on behalf of the owner of the object is the actual donor. Chapter 27, Loan, Pledge, Guarantee, and Administration. Loan is a giving similar to alms, in that it is commended by the Lord. He forbade refusing to give it, as said in the Gospel. Lend and do not frustrate the hope of anybody. He also said, if a man would borrow from thee, do not refuse him. To be eager to repay the debt is commendable, and to repay it on time if possible is in accordance with the law. As the prophet David said, the sinner borrows and never repays, but the good man has mercy and gives. The lender must wait patiently until the borrower is able to pay him, since the Lord has said, do not search for one who borrows money, and do not compel him to pay while he is oppressed by the force of his poverty. In connection with this, our Lord has told the parable of the servant who compelled his debtor to pay. Loan may be upon pledge, guarantee of death, guarantee of person, or upon a written deed attested by witnesses. The handwriting of the borrower on the written deed, or solely the trust put in him, may be sufficient, but it is preferable that there be witnesses who attest the written deed. Loan may be immediate or for a future time, and repayment of the loan must be made at its proper time, when the lender requests it, or if possible earlier, before it is requested. The repayment shall consist of an object of the same type as was borrowed, or its price at the time of repayment, whichever of the two the debtor prefers, an object of the same kind as was borrowed, or another thing, the value of which is proportioned to the loan at the time of repayment. If special conditions were laid down regarding repayment, they must be observed. If the debtor says, "I am not able to pay the debt," the creditor may take any belonging of the debtor, pursuant to the order of the judge and the opinion and calculation of reliable persons, whether or not the debtor agrees. In case the borrower denies having incurred the debt, the instrument he endorsed is introduced to contradict him. No calculation shall be made in his favor, but all his possessions shall be taken from him. And one who denies his creditor that in which he is indebted and swears to it, but witnesses prove him false, shall pay double the amount. But if after the denial he admits it at the moment of taking the oath, he shall be exonerated from paying double. As for the loan upon pledge, if the pledge yields profit or fruit, whatever benefit derived from the pledge goes to the hand of the lender, must be credited to the borrower's amount and offset the debt to that extent. As for usury, we have to avoid it, since the divine law has forbidden it. If the lender takes any object in any way from the borrower, it is considered partial repayment of the loan. When the creditor is paid by the creditor must return the pledge to its owner. The creditor must return the extra amount to the debtor if the latter pays him more than what he owes him. A claim shall be made by the debtor for anything that is found missing from the profit or the price of the fruit of the pledge. The one who takes a pledge must care for the pledge as he does for his own property. If he loses it, he shall not be required to pay it if he produces witnesses who testify that he did not lose it by fault. Otherwise, he must pay for or replace the pledge with another of value equal to what has been lost. If lender and borrower have made an agreement contemplating the possibility that the pledge will be lost by the lender before the debt is restored, the judge shall decide pursuant to the agreement they made. The parties' claims cancel each other if the pledge was lost due to the creditor's fault, if it was of the same value as the amount of the credit. The creditor who had the pledge shall give his debtor the extra amount if the value of the lost pledge exceeded the amount of the credit. But if the value of the pledge was less, the debtor shall pay the remainder of the loan in due time. The lender may claim what he has spent for the maintenance of the pledge from the borrower. If an agreement was made to the effect that after the expiration of the period set for payment, the pledge will be sold if the debt has not been paid, let it be so. But the one who took the pledge must not sell it for a price lower than its actual value, nor shall he exchange it for other goods without the order of the judge. If he sells it independently of the advice of others for a lower price than its true value, the difference shall be claimed. The estimation of the value shall be fixed according to the testimony of the borrower, supported by an oath. The pledge which is with the lender or with his heir shall be given back to its owner when the latter repays what he has borrowed, except in those cases where there was an agreement between them whereby the lender might take possession of the pledge instead of claiming his credit, provided that the time for payment has elapsed without payment and the value of the pledge equals the loan. If a part of the pledge dies, or if, in case the pledge is a slave, the one who has given him as pledge manumits him, or if the debtor gives the pledge away as alms or as a charitable legacy, he shall pay its price instead of it, or discharge the debt. If the borrower is so poor that he could neither pay for manumission nor give alms or a charitable legacy before he has paid the debt, he cannot dispose of the pledge in such a way that the benefits due to the lender at the time of payment are destroyed, as might happen if the debtor sells or donates it, nor may he dispose of it in such a way that the value of the pledge depreciates, as, for instance, if he demolishes a wall where the pledge is a house. But the borrower may utilize the pledge in a manner that does not entail any damage to it, such as enjoying its products, using the young of the animals, or drawing rent provided that the duration of the lease is less than the duration of the debt, unless it was agreed otherwise. No one can give as pledge what cannot be sold. As for instance, a slave who is already manumitted, a house previously given as a charitable legacy, or something that will perish before the date of payment. If a dispute arises because of an alleged substitution or something else for the pledge, let the dispute be settled according to the testimony supported by oath of the one who had the pledge. If the latter only alleges that he has given the true pledge back to its owner, his statement shall not be accepted. Neither the whole nor the parts shall leave the hands of the one who took the pledge if its value increases after it has been taken as pledge. The pledge shall remain in the hands of the creditor or in the hands of a trusted person if there was such an agreement between the two parties. The rights of the lender, the borrower, and the trusted person over the pledge shall be according to the pertinent rule. The same rule applies to the heirs of the pledgee and the borrower after death, as well as to those who are entitled to the pledge by virtue of a will, those whom the judge authorizes to accept payment of the debt, those who are under guardianship during their lifetime and after their death, and the judge if the above-mentioned persons are missing. If someone has left anything belonging to him with another person for a period of 30 years and has not asked for it, he cannot claim it after the expiration of this period, nor can his son. The same principle governs administration on behalf of another. But if a pledge is in the hands of the claimant and has been in his possession for 30 years without passing to another, he may either demand the return of the object given on loan or keep the pledge in his possession. But he may not do this if the pledge has passed to the possession of another. The same principle also applies to legal actions for debt, inheritances, the fees for judgment, laws, partnerships, fraud, the boundaries of lands, wells, streams flowing besides houses and through towns, gardens, and similar things. If one brings an action for any of these after 30 years has elapsed, he may not be given any relief. A father shall not be liable for a loan contracted by his son. If it is proved that the son borrowed without his father's permission, neither is a man responsible for the debt incurred by his mother, nor the brother, for the debt of his brother, or for his father-in-law, unless he acted as a guarantor. A guarantee of debt and a guarantee of person are two distinct things with different meanings. A guarantee of person is a guarantee to produce a person, while a guarantee of debt is a guarantee to pay a debt. A guarantee of debt is thus a guarantee of debt given for a person whose means are known, and for a determined period of time, is valid. One may act as guarantor for a person of sound mind only at his request, but a guarantee on behalf of a person who is mentally incapable may be given without his request. One who stood as guarantor at a person's request may claim whatever he has paid on his behalf. But the one who stood as guarantor without the guaranteed person's request cannot reclaim anything from him except the amount he paid for his maintenance. The form of words to be used when giving a guarantee of debt is thus. The guarantor shall say, I, A, stand guarantor on behalf of B, for a specified amount. If a person has said, I stand guarantor on behalf of B, for what he owes to C, and this is proved by witnesses, he is liable for what he guaranteed at that time, but not for what the debtor alleges without producing witnesses. A guarantee of debt wherein the guarantor says, throw your property into the sea and your dresses into the fire on my guarantee, is not valid. The lender must claim his property from the borrower and claim it from the guarantor only if the debtor does not pay him. If the borrower goes far from the country, the judge shall grant a period of time to the guarantor to find him. If he does not succeed in finding him within that period of time, Let the creditor stretch his hands to take the borrower's property in proportion to the debt, if it is sufficient to meet the debt. Otherwise, let him stretch his hand towards the guarantor's property in proportion to the debt. The lender must first sue the debtor and then the latter's guarantor. If there is a secondary guarantor, the lender has recourse against each of them. If any of them dies, his liability devolves upon the survivors. If the creditor releases any of the others liable and gives up his claim, the guarantor shall be released as well, and the claim against him shall be cancelled. If one of the guarantors has paid the debt, the creditor's claim against the others concerning the loan is cancelled. In the case there are several guarantors, each of whom guaranteed the payment of the whole debt, the creditor may demand its repayment from any of them, and the one who paid the debt on behalf of the others may require each of them to pay him the portion he has paid in excess of his share of the debt, that is, half of the debt if they were two, one quarter each if they were four. If none of them has guaranteed repayment of the full debt, but each has bound himself only to the extent of his share, the creditor may not require any one guarantor to pay the full debt, but only his individual share, for instance, only one quarter if they were four. If a creditor and a debtor for whom someone stood as guarantor have made an agreement to extinguish a part of the debt, no action lies against the guarantor of the second guarantor concerning the extinguished portion of the debt, but the guarantor shall be liable for what the debtor agreed to pay. A guarantee of debt must be given for a fixed period of time, and the guarantor must say, I stand guarantor of A for a specified object until a specified time. The guarantor may give the debtor the guaranteed amount at any time, in order to rid himself of the obligation. If the guarantor and the debtor make an agreement about some object, the guarantor must give the object of the debtor to the creditor. He may put it to any use until the creditor asks him for it. Any profit he gains from the object or any loss he incurs is his own concern. No creditor shall refuse to accept what the debtor offers him in payment of his debt whenever he offers it to him. One cannot make any demand upon the guarantor unless the guarantee is valid according to the provisions of the law. Should the debtor die, the guarantor may claim the amount he paid from the debtor's heirs, provided that he had some property. If the guarantor dies, leaving some property, the creditor has an action against his heirs. If not, he may not claim it from his heirs, who was not a guarantor. A guarantor of person binds himself to produce that person. The formula for this type of guarantee is that one says, I guarantee to produce A before C, or I guarantee to produce the face of A before C, or I will answer for A. If a guarantor undertook to produce someone at some specified time, he shall be asked to produce the person when the time is due. If the time for production of the person is not fixed, the guarantor shall produce him when asked to do so. The guarantor shall be released if he produces the person before the time appointed, and the creditor can prevent the person from escaping. So also if the person surrenders himself to the creditor of his own will. If the debtor cannot be produced on the date fixed, the judge must grant the guarantor an extension of time to bring the person before him. If he does not succeed in bringing him within that time, and if he stood guarantor only for his face, he is merely responsible for bringing him in. But if there was an agreement whereby the guarantor bound himself to discharge a debt in the event that he failed to produce the person on request, and he fails to produce the person, he shall become guarantor for the debt, and his condition is thus. From that moment, he shall be considered as guarantor for the amount lent. If a guarantor of person is not found and another stood as guarantor of him, each one is responsible for the guarantee of person he undertook. One cannot be guarantor of a person for one who has been condemned to death. If the person for whom one stood guarantor dies, an action may be brought against his guarantor. The creditor, however, must first sue the debtor. If he does not find him, he shall then sue the guarantor of his person. A priest cannot act as a guarantor for anyone, nor can he take any objects as pledge. nor shall a woman stand as guarantor of a person or debt. As for loan upon a written deed or upon a trust, if the debtor denies having incurred the debt, it shall be claimed by challenging the debtor to swear. If he takes the oath, but after this witnesses testify that the written deed is his, he will be judged as a debtor. Who denies his creditor on oath is judged. We have dealt with this at the beginning of this chapter. If he does not take the oath, he is liable for whatever is stated in the written instrument. If there is no written document, but there is written guarantee of debt, the debtor shall pay on the basis of the written guarantee. And you must note, as is said in the Mosaic Law, that God warns creditors to abstain from putting pressure on a debtor who is unable to pay his debt, as by taking from him the garment he is wearing. The Lord also forbade the lender from asking his debtor to pay him, and, as said in the Gospel, quoted at the beginning of this chapter, God warns the creditor not to sue his debtor or ill-treat him. Therefore, one must not abuse the needy. If a debt is to be repaid on a definite day, the debtor must be asked to pay only at that time. If creditors have no confidence in a debtor, the former shall be given a guarantor by the order of the judge. If a debtor has some property that can be claimed and his creditor asked the judge to give his decision apportioning that property, let the judge do so. If the debtor wishes to sell property to pay his debt, let him first sell, through a person he trusts, those things which are readily available in his presence and in the presence of the creditors or of his and their guarantors. The price must be equitable and carefully determined. Perishable objects shall be sold first, then beast, and then buildings. Everything shall be sold in the marketplace, in the presence of the creditor's family. The debtor shall pay only the debt which becomes clearly known through the testimony of witnesses. He shall not pay upon the mere assertion of the creditors, and shall be careful not to be deceived. A debtor's admission of liability is not sufficient by itself. There shall be no violence towards the debtor. What is necessary for him to keep shall be determined according to his position in life. In case the property of a debtor is not sufficient to discharge his debt, his creditors shall share the available property in proportion to the amount each loaned. If the price of the debtor's property is sufficient to make his creditors whole, he shall be given the whole price. If at that time the proceeds of the scale are greater than the loan, the excess shall be given to the debtor. If the debtor claims to have no property and tells his creditors of his poverty, but his creditors ascertain through the mouths of people who know his true condition that he spoke falsely, let the judge put him in chains until he pays them. If they wish, they may require him to take the oath and release him if he swears that he is poor. If the debtor's poverty is proved by the testimony of two witnesses who know his condition, the creditor must wait until his poverty passes. If he draws wages, he shall be required to pay a certain amount to his creditor after deducting what he needs to live. If his poverty is not ascertained, his release shall be delayed. Chapter 28. Loan for Use. A loan for use is one in which the borrower derives benefit, as determined by an agreement, without paying for it. If someone borrows a beast to use until he reaches a predetermined place, and then goes beyond that place, he is liable for whatever harm may befall it, or if it died, if he does not go beyond the point agreed upon. But what befell the beast happened because of his laziness, or because of the manner in which he treated it, he is liable. But if it is not so, or if the owner of the beast was himself with the borrower, he is not liable. If the beast is hired and perishes, its death is encompassed by its rent. If the borrower goes beyond the predetermined place, he shall give the lender of the beast an amount additional to that agreed upon as rent for having passed the agreed limit. Whosoever is entitled to dispose of his property may lend whatever he may dispose of, and may hire whatever yields him profit. Getting his property back in its original condition, he shall receive the price of what is lost as of the day it is lost, and an additional amount if the borrower went beyond the place agreed upon. If the thing borrowed is an animal, the borrower is not responsible if it dies or flees unless he has produced a guarantor for its safe return. In a dispute, the lender's word supported by his oath shall be accepted. In any case, it is better not to borrow, to give a pledge, or to hire without the lender's consent to keep the object for a fixed period of time. The one who gives a free loan may claim its property whenever he wishes, unless an agreement has been previously entered into, the time for return has been fixed, or the use to be made of the object has not been completed. A lender cannot take back capital with interest, as in the case of diners, silver coins, or other objects which may be measured and weighed, since this would be loaned with interest and not a gratuitous loan. Chapter 29, Deposit, and what is added to it. A deposit is an object which the depositor delivers to the depositee so that the latter may keep it for the former without retaining for himself the fruits it bore when he restores it. A deposit is an object deposited by its owner upon trust in the depositee. One who has received a deposit must keep it with great care as great as he applies to his own property. He shall not be liable if it perishes despite his diligence. It may be that the depositee will offer to return it to its owner while it is in good condition, and the owner will refuse to accept it. If it then perishes or becomes spoiled by a natural occurrence, as might an animal which is mortal, or something which can be eaten by moths, or if something then happens to it which the depositee cannot prevent, such as fire, shipwreck, pillage, theft, or robbery, he shall not pay unless reliable witnesses testify that this took place because of his fraud, his bad administration, or his failure to care for it as his own property. If there is no testimony or reliable witnesses, the matter must be investigated. He must pay if there was a special agreement between them concerning the deposit. If the owner asked for the deposit and the depositee refuses to return it, although he could do so, or if the depositee at first denies having received it and later admits it, he shall return the deposit only. If he has used it as if it were a loan to him, or has lent it to a person, or has hired others with it, or has given it as pledge or as a loan with interest to be paid by the borrower, he shall give a guarantee of death to return it to the care of the one who gave it to him. If the depositee transfers the deposit to another person without being under the necessity of going on a journey or having another good reason to transfer it, he shall give a guarantee of debt to return it. And the second depositee must not give it to the owner unless he has an order from the one who deposited it with him, either his word given face to face or his message delivered either by an envoy or in an evidently authentic letter. The one to whom a deposit is entrusted may not refuse the writing of the depositor by which the deposit with him is described, nor may he refuse to make out a list of the objects deposited with him, and if the depositor has ordered that the deposit is not to be displayed, but the depositee shows it to someone, or if he gave orders that it was not to be given to a certain person and the depositee gives it to that person, or if the depositor instructed him to put it in a definite place, specifying the place he did not want it put, and the depositee refuses to follow the instructions with justifiable cause, he shall be liable to pay the depositor if the deposit is lost. If a person inherits a deposit from the depositee and, knowing that it was a deposit and able to remind its owner of it, fails to inform the owner, he is liable to pay. If the depositee wants to travel to a distant place and can find neither the owner nor his administrator, he shall entrust the deposit to a judge, or, if this cannot be done, to a trusted person. If he cannot find the owner of the deposit, he shall wait for him until the time after which a person of the owner's age is most likely to be alive. He shall then transfer it to the depositor's heirs. If the depositor has no heirs, the command is that it must be given to the altar as alms for the salvation of the owner's soul, either by making a legacy or by giving the deposit as alms on his behalf, whether through the order of a judge or before witnesses. The depositor and the depositee may terminate the contract of deposit whenever they wish, provided that the depositee can restore the deposit and the depositor can receive it. If one of the two parties refuses, he is liable and the other is free from any responsibility. Whatever is obtained from the deposit and set aside for the benefit of the depositor and whatever is similar to this is governed by the provisions on deposit. And similarly, anything produced by the deposit or any benefit derived from it or the like is governed by the provisions on a deposit entrusted to one in the presence of a judge. The one who received a deposit from its owner through the hand of his envoy must give it back to the owner, not to his envoy, unless the owner orders otherwise, since the deposit belongs to the owner. If the owner dies, the deposit shall be given to his heirs, and he who receives a deposit from the one who bids him to give it to another shall personally deliver the deposit to the said person and inform him that it is a deposit. A depositee shall not restore a deposit to its owner through another's hands. If two individuals deposit something with a third person, the latter shall not return it to either of them without the consent of the other. The one with whom a slave or an animal is deposited shall be held liable if the deposit dies because he failed to give it food or drink. Even if the depositor told the depositee to give them neither food nor drink, the latter may claim compensation from the former for whatever he supplied them. If the depositor refuses to pay him, the deposit shall remain with the depositee as a pledge in proportion to the expenses he incurred and ceases to be a deposit from that time. If a dispute arises over the deposit and the reimbursement of the expenses, let it be settled according to the word of the depositee supported by his oath, since the depositor has entrusted his object to him. But if the depositor produces reliable witnesses, let the dispute be settled pursuant to his word. No one may take a deposit except the person who may dispose of his property and demand it back. That is, the person who is entitled to take back his property, being capable of disposing of and receiving it. The contract of deposit ceases upon the death of the depositee, or until the depositee recovers his reason, if he is possessed by the devil. And the one who received a deposit and later became aware that the depositor had stolen it or had taken it by violence must be sentenced to pay double. Whosoever does not take care of the deposit as he would of his own property commits a fraud. The depositor may sue him as a fraudulent, bad-hearted, and negligent person unless there was a special agreement between them, since in that case, the judgment regarding the substance deposited is different.